It's a huge privilege to welcome today John Barton as our speaker in this fourth Archdeaconry Day on the Year of the Bible. He is a distinguished Old Testament scholar, a professor emeritus from Oxford, who has written widely in the field of the Old Testament, particularly on prophets, the biblical canon and biblical interpretation. He was telling me that he generally has written short books of introduction, but is now about to complete a more major work, which Penguin are going to publish soon, so watch this space for the next production from him. He is also a parish priest, and so knows something of the context in which many of us work in terms of communicating the mystery of the Bible and the Word of God revealed in Holy Scripture. John, thank you so much for coming to speak to us. We look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Well, thank you very much, Bishop, for those kind words, and thank you very much for the invitation to give this lecture today. It's very nice to be back in Arundel after about 50-odd years. When I was a child growing up in West London, we used to have our holidays in Brackelsham Bay, or when we became a little richer, in West Wittering. And Arundel was the first castle I ever saw, and Chichester the first cathedral I ever saw, so it's very nice to be back in the diocese after such a very long time. Now, the title I've been given for today is Biblical Criticism in a Secular Culture. Biblical Criticism in a Secular Culture. And that sounds as though it's in the realms of high theory. It also sounds a bit counterintuitive, because it seems to be contrasting biblical criticism with secular culture. Whereas most people probably think of biblical criticism as being, in fact, a rather secular approach to the Bible anyway. Sometimes opponents of biblical criticism speak of getting the Bible back for the church from the secular world into which critical study has put it. Certainly many clergy in training feel as though the Bible is being taken from them by the biblical critics and that they'll never get it back again. What I've decided to do anyway is to talk in a rather practical way about the use and appropriation of the Bible within our culture, and then towards the end to ask whether what I've been doing can be reckoned as biblical criticism. And perhaps it can't, but we'll see. If you go to the British Museum and visit the Sainsbury Gallery, the Sainsbury African Gallery, you'll see a thing called a Tree of Life, which is made from parts of guns. It's a monument to an initiative by a Catholic bishop in Mozambique, which was taken up and developed by Christian Aid. During the Cold War, millions of weapons flooded into Mozambique, and their continued existence gravely threatened the country's peace as they came to be used for settling internal disputes. There was an initiative in 1995 called Transforming Arms into Tools, in which people could bring their guns to a collecting point and receive in return agricultural implements. And the Tree of Life made of bits of guns celebrates this venture, by which instruments of death have been replaced with instruments of life. The guns that were death dealing have been changed into a tree, the symbol of new life. Well, now, anyone who reads the Bible is bound to be reminded of Isaiah 2:4. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. The same passage occurs in Micah 4. And this prophecy, we could say, was being fulfilled in what was happening in Mozambique. Minds nourished on this text found a way of acting that promoted human flourishing in a war-torn country. And I want to suggest that this can provide us with a model for starting to think about how Scripture can be fruitful for all of us in trying to live a Christian life, what use one can actually make of the Bible in practice. This text and others like it provides an inspiration to the Christian mind. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. There can be moments when certain texts seem to leap out at us. You'll remember that St. Anthony, an early monk of the Egyptian desert, is said to be motivated to take up the religious life when he went to church one day and happened to hear in the gospel reading, "Go and sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven." Mark 10. And any text in the Bible may suddenly light up for us in this way as a source of wisdom for the present moment. A similar thing is said to have happened to St. Augustine, who picked up the book and suddenly saw a text which somehow transformed his life. But now here, several critical points need to be teased out. First of all, most biblical passages don't have the form of laws that have to be obeyed. Most of them are not commands, and that's true of the swords into plowshares passage. Very little of the Bible is like the Ten Commandments, or even like the Sermon on the Mount. Most of it is narrative or reflection or praise. The text from Isaiah may have inspired the Transforming Arms into Tools project, but it's not a direct command as it stands. And indeed, there's a less known verse in the book of Joel, in Joel 3:10, that reverses it and says, in a time of war, beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Well, which one shall we follow? No one who loves peace would want the people of Mozambique to act on that text, but it's equally a biblical text. We need discrimination in reading the Bible so as to see just which texts promote human flourishing. We can't simply take any text at random and assume that it expresses a divine command that we have to obey. Secondly, very little of the Bible, even the books of the prophets, are predictions of the future that can come true in a literal sense. The text from Isaiah 2 about the swords into plowshares is relevant in many different circumstances, but it's not a prediction of one particular event. There are Christians who try to work out a detailed scenario for God's plan for the world from Scripture, but this is an impossible task, as well as a pointless one, especially in view of Jesus' warnings that the accomplishment of God's purposes always comes when we least expect it, so the project is doomed from the start. So thus, the Bible is a source of insight in these circumstances rather than of direct commands or literal prophecies. It offers us wisdom, not rulings or futurescapes. And this, of course, can be true of many books apart from the Bible. But Christians have always regarded the Bible as a particularly concentrated source of wisdom. And no amount of biblical criticism, whether friendly or hostile, has succeeded in undermining that. Though, I want to argue, biblical criticism hasn't had that as its aim anyway. Christians have experienced the Bible not as an inert document, but as a living resource, as Cranmer put it, a fountain and well of truth. And there's a rather nice quotation from the preface to the Authorised Version, the Translators to the Reader, which is not printed in most copies of the Authorised Version you can buy now, but it contains this passage, which is in rather, of course, in Elizabethan prose, but sums up this point about the fruitfulness of the Bible. They say there, "The scripture is not only an armour, but a whole armoury of weapons, both offensive and defensive, whereby we may save ourselves and put the enemy to flight. It is not a herb, but a tree, or rather a whole paradise of trees of life, which bring forth fruit every month, and the fruit thereof is for food, and the leaves for medicine. It is not a pot of manna or a cruse of oil, which were for a meal's meat or two, but as it were a shower of heavenly bread sufficient for a whole host, be it never so great, and as it were a whole cellar full of oil vessels, whereby all our necessities may be provided for, and all our debts discharged. In a word, it is a pantry of wholesome food and a volume of profitable laws against rebellious spirits, a treasury of most costly jewels, and finally a fountain of pure water springing up into everlasting life." Catching that phrase again from Cranmer. And so we start with the assumption that the Bible will nourish us and will be fruitful for us in some way or other. Now, I want to suggest several ways in which this can happen. And the first is to think of the Bible as an icon. Now, the Bible is an icon in the sense in which icon is often used nowadays. The Bible is iconic. It stands for certain things in our culture. But I mean something a bit more than that. I mean a real analogy with the icons used in Eastern Orthodox churches. Orthodox writers tell us that icons work with a technique of perspective different from what we're used to in Western art. In a Western picture, the lines of perspective converge on a point which has to be imagined as behind the surface of the picture. Icons, they say, on the other hand, are constructed so that the lines converge in front of the picture, and the point of convergence is the worshipper standing in front of the icon. The icon reaches out to the worshipper. I'm not sure whether this is a literal or a metaphorical point. I think it's a metaphorical one, but it's certainly a powerful way of thinking about icons. The icon does not invite us to enter its world, still less to penetrate behind it. It challenges us to allow ourselves to receive its message, to be worked on by the icon, rather than working on it ourselves. And thus icons, which to many Western Christians, and I have to admit to myself, seem in many ways so smooth and bland and two-dimensional, can be perceived as reaching forward to the worshipper, who constitutes the picture's third dimension and who's needed to complete its effect. The icon opens up fresh possibilities for each new person who looks at it. The icon is not closed, it's inherently open, and by its very nature, open to fresh understandings and interpretations. It's designed to become part of a dialogue with each person who seeks God by contemplating it. Now, my suggestion is that it can be rather the same with the Bible. When we read the Bible, we're not just reading a flat text, something inert. We're opening ourselves for it to act upon us, and we want to unite all our other experience with what the text has to say to us. The Bible is not like a reference book that we look up when we need it, at least it's not only that. It's a kind of conversation partner for us, which reaches out to us and seeks to transform our own mind. Many readers of the Bible have expressed this by saying that they started by trying to read the Bible, but soon found that the Bible was reading them. This is maybe a slightly exaggerated way of describing the experience, but it does try to convey the sense that an encounter with the Bible is an encounter with the person who speaks to us through it. The process can change us, rather than being like the experience of reading a textbook or some other document that simply provides information or instructions or predictions. It actually has an existential dimension. Now, something similar can happen with other literary works, of course. And one question that needs addressing is whether the Bible is different in essence, or only in degree, or even not different at all, but just an example of a general truth. Reading a novel, after all, is also not much like reading a textbook. It's a self-involving experience, and the more so, the better the novel. Good novels engage us in our own being and can transform how we see the world. Often not because they tell us things we didn't know, but because they invite us to compare our own lives with those of the people we're reading about, and to see fresh possibilities for how we might live. Christian experience is that there are parts of the Bible that are uniquely or almost uniquely able to do this. When we read about Jesus as he's presented in the Gospels, we're not just reading an interesting story. We don't say, oh, fancy that, at the end of a story about Jesus. We are being challenged and brought up short by a life that impacts on our own choices and plans. And that may happen through a particular verse, as it did for St. Anthony or St. Augustine. But perhaps more commonly it comes from the whole sweep of the narrative about Jesus in the Gospels, as this asks us, could you live like that? What is striking about icons is that they aim to present a universal picture of the person represented, unlike the individuality of the typical Western portrait. and yet at the same time they speak differently to each individual worshipper. And there is a similar paradox about the Bible. We don't each have a personalised Bible. The Bible is the same for us all. Yet different parts come alive for different people at different times in their lives. The main reason why we need to become quite familiar with the Bible is so that it can speak to us just when we need to hear it, with this or that passage slipping into our mind. We need a kind of repertoire of familiar biblical texts, above all real familiarity with the story the Gospels tell us. Knowing the text by heart is an important aspect of this, which was much stressed in the past. It's become much more difficult, of course, with modern translations, because you can't now remember, except in a rather fuzzy way, what each text has in it. And that's a drawback. There are many advantages to modern translations, of course, as well, which I'm not knocking. But there is some advantage in having a version you know by heart, or more or less. But it's not only stories that can operate on us in an icon-like way. The teaching on how we should live in Paul's letters has the same luminous quality. And reflecting on it often, turning it over and over in the mind, can have a powerful effect in shaping our character as Christians. Again, it's not a matter of treating it as a kind of legal code. It's a matter of letting ourselves muse on what it would be like really to take it to heart and let it remake us. Take, for example, Galatians 5:22. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, this is not really a set of directives. You can't go through it and tick whether you've done each of those things. It's a rounded description of a certain type of character, and it comes forward out of the text to challenge us and inspire us. Knowing how to apply it, say, in our work situation is far from easy. It doesn't rule on the difficult issues we face every day in any specific way. If we ask what the Bible has to say to some of the burning questions of our day, it's often very hard to answer because it comes from a different world. Getting it to rule on modern economic problems or something like the ethics of abortion is very far from easy. Not that kind of book. It isn't designed for that purpose. Yet we would recognise without much trouble someone who had taken St. Paul's ethical insights into their system. We would feel better for knowing such a person, and we'd also start to wonder how well we were living our own life. One of the essential features of icons is their ability to surprise us. We can't predict what they will say to us on any given occasion. They witness to the God whom Augustine described as the beauty so old and yet so new. And the Bible has a similar ability to surprise us. There's no point in trying to conceal that it sometimes surprises us by saying things that as Christians we can't accept. If you read through Joshua, for example, you are not likely to feel highly inspired. You're likely to feel alienated from the picture of God the book apparently commends. But most of the time, the surprise is a salutary one. There may be salutary surprises even in Joshua, but that's going further afield than I want to go at the moment. There are plenty of texts that surprise us in a wholesome way without our needing to go through explanations of Joshua. And I want to sum up how the Bible can surprise us in two ways, in two expressions, which I borrowed from the Lutheran tradition of thinking about Scripture. The first is that the Bible tells us who we are. And the second is that the Bible tells us what we can't tell ourselves. The Bible tells us who we are, and the Bible tells us what we can't tell ourselves. And these two formulas can help to sharpen up our understanding of what it is we go to Scripture to learn. First then, the Bible tells us who we are. Luther said that the whole message of the Bible is about humanity, which may sound rather odd. Surely the Bible is primarily about God, you might think. But Luther was right, for in the Bible we read about God only as related to the human race, through the creation of humankind, through Israel, through Jesus, through the church. What God reveals to us in the Bible is not the divine nature, which is above our grasp, but human nature as created and redeemed by God. We go to Scripture first and foremost to learn who we really are as God's children. And we find that this is very different from the picture of humanity many of our secular contemporaries believe in. On the one hand, according to the biblical picture, human beings can be much worse than secular optimists sometimes believe, utterly corrupt and death-bringing. On the other hand, the psalmist tells us that they are little lower than the angels, little lower than gods, perhaps the text means, Psalm 8, which goes much further in a positive direction than our secular culture is prepared to affirm. Christians understand from the Bible what human beings are like in more extreme ways than the secular culture around us affirms, in either direction, either good or bad. The Bible encourages us both to realise just how terrible we have it in us to be, and yet also how much more generous and open to God we can be than most people can conceive. Scripture challenges both our facile optimism and our cynical pessimism about ourselves and our fellow human beings. In the story of Jesus, we see how low human nature can sink as a truly selfless man is tortured to death. But we also see what the human animal is capable of becoming, and we are reassured that it's with someone like Jesus that God aligns himself, since he brings him back from the dead and gives him eternal life. The resurrection of Jesus is good news because of the kind of person Jesus was and is. Resurrection in itself is not good news. A message in the New Testament that said, well, you can be relieved to know that Pontius Pilate has been restored to life, would not be good news in the sense that the resurrection of Jesus is. Sometimes people think that Paul says that all that matters is the mere fact of the resurrection, but he must have had an idea that Jesus was the kind of person you would want to see resurrected. When we read the Bible, therefore, we should always have in our mind the question, what does this passage tell me about myself and about other people? And the answer may not be obvious. And I want to take as an example the parable of the labourers in the vineyard, which will be coming up in the lectionary in the next few weeks, last Sunday in September, I think. And let me just read it through. I'm sure we all know it, but I want to just read it and let us reflect on it. Matthew 20. The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire labourers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the labourers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, you also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right. So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, that's the 11th hour in traditional translations, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, why are you standing here idle all day? They said to him, because no one has hired us. He said to them, you also go into the vineyard. When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, call the labourers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first. When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. When the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, these last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. But he replied to one of them, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last. Now, if we treat this parable as a ruling on labour relations, we quickly find ourselves in very deep trouble. I remember many sermons on this in the 60s on the theme, the unions will never stand it. When they first hear the parable, children are often incensed at the unfairness of the employer's action. To mobilise the parable in an industrial dispute would be to court disaster. But the parable is not intended to lay down guidelines for how to run a business, a subject of which Jesus may have had little experience, unless the family firm he worked in as a carpenter was used to hiring people. The parable is intended to tell us who we are. What it tells us about ourselves is that we are the objects of God's infinite love and mercy, since he gives to us freely and without regard for what we think we deserve, whether because we underestimate it or because we overestimate it. Our own merits are not the point. It tells us that God does not treat us in the way a normal employer would treat his workers, but is disproportionately generous. It makes the same point, in fact, as the parable of the prodigal son in Luke, where again you remember the elder brother who complained, rather like the man who came at the first hour. We are all, to quote Luther again, both sinners and justified at the same time. That is, we are treated by God as though we were not sinners at all. We are both creatures made of dust, and yet little lower than the angels. We only understand the passage rightly when we shift our attention from the very natural question of whether the landowner was just, and ask instead what it's like to be on the receiving end of the mercy of God, for which the landowner's actions stand. We then learn that God is loving to us all equally, irrespective of whether we are deserving or undeserving. If we are deserving, we have nothing to complain of, and if we are undeserving, we have much to be thankful for. That's how the parable, I think, works. This is grasped perfectly in that famous sermon by St. John Chrysostom, the Bishop of Constantinople from 398 till he died in exile in 407, which is read in the Orthodox liturgy for Easter night, which I'm sure many people are familiar with. It speaks of those who have kept or failed to keep the Lenten fast in terms borrowed from the parable. It runs like this. If any be lovers of God, let them rejoice in this beautiful and radiant feast. If any be faithful servants, let them gladly enter into the joy of their Lord. If any are wearied with fasting, let them now reap their reward. If any have laboured from the first hour, let them receive today their just wages. If any have come after the third hour, let them celebrate the feast with thankfulness. If any have arrived after the sixth hour, let them not doubt, for they will sustain no loss. If any have delayed until the ninth hour, let them not hesitate, but draw near. If any have arrived only at the 11th hour, let them not be ashamed because they have arrived so late. For the Master is gracious and welcomes the last no less than the first. He gives rest to those who come at the 11th hour just as kindly as to those who have laboured since dawn. The first he fills to overflowing, on the last he has compassion. To the one he grants his favour, to the other pardon. He does not look only at the work, he looks into the intention of the heart. Enter then, all of you, into the joy of your Master. First and last, receive alike your reward. Rich and poor, dance together. Rejoice today, you who kept the Lenten fast, and you who failed to keep it. Marvellous final line, I think. What the parable of the labourers in the vineyard tells us about ourselves, if you read it this way, is that none of us deserves anything, and yet all are given the utmost riches that God can provide. And consequently, none of us has any right to complain that others are included in God's bounty. We are all beggars whom God has made rich. We are all justified sinners. There's a bus that runs from Oxford to London, which is known as the Oxford Tube, and for many years it had an advert on the side which ran, "Every seat first class, every ticket economy." And that seems to me to sum up the parable of the labourers in the vineyard very well. To read this parable as offering rules about the labour market thus misunderstands it completely. What it tells us is that in relating to human beings, God does not follow rules of fairness. If he did, no one would get anything at all, but follows the principle of love, which gives people what they don't deserve. The generosity of God makes us all people living on divine benefits, in no position to look down on anyone else. And that does have immense practical implications, especially in any political and social system that claims to rest on Christian values. The question the reader needs to ask is, if this is what the parable tells us about ourselves, then how ought we to live? What kind of people should we be trying to be if we owe everything to the free love of God? What attitude should that involve towards other people whom God loves just as he loves us, whether they are better than we are, worse than we are, or much the same as we are? And how will that play out in our corporate and political and individual lives? What would it be to love other people in the free way God loves us? It's easy enough to answer that question in theory, but very hard to know how to express a love like that appropriately in the workplace and in normal social life, where there are all sorts of constraints and regulations that also need to be respected. The gospel passage, though, can inform the underlying attitude with which we approach all the people we come into contact with. Our witness to our belief in the truth of the gospel will be expressed in treating everyone as though they were, like us, recipients of God's free gifts, our equals in God's sight, whatever their status in worldly terms. It is the work of a whole lifetime to make this effective in practice, and though we never fully succeed, at least we should know what we should be aiming for. That was my first slogan, "The Bible tells us who we are." The second is, "The Bible tells us what we cannot tell ourselves." Christians have traditionally described the Bible as inspired and as containing revelation from God. There are a lot of very complicated theories about how God reveals truth through Scripture, some of which have the effect of treating it as infallible or inerrant. More liberal Christians think these theories exaggerate the difference between the Bible and other writings, and that the Bible should be seen as the work of human beings who were in touch with God, rather than as the words of God himself. This is an area of sharp disagreement among Christians. The current Roman Catholic position is interesting, summed up in a document produced by the Pontifical Biblical Commission a few years ago called The Inspiration and Truth of Sacred Scripture, which makes extremely high claims for the inspiration of the Bible, practically as high as those made by quite conservative evangelical Christians. So there's quite an area of agreement there, but there's quite an area of disagreement with what some other Christians think. But it's possible to start with a more modest claim on which most Christians would agree, and this can be summed up in my formula or slogan, "The Bible teacher tells us what we cannot tell ourselves." We learn from Scripture truths we don't learn from anywhere else, truths we would never have arrived at under our own steam. And if that's the definition of revelation, then the Scripture reveals. Whether or not it's a fully adequate way of speaking about revelation through the Bible, it does give us a good starting point. The Bible has the capacity to surprise us by offering us insights we are, let's say, at least very unlikely to find anywhere else. It challenges many of our assumptions, and it provides the impetus for a way of life radically different from the one we would choose by the light of nature. And I want to illustrate this from a story in the second book of Kings, in 2 Kings 5, the story of Naaman, which again I'm sure you know, but which I'm afraid I'm going to read. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Aram, was a great man and in high favour with his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Aram. The man, though a mighty warrior, suffered from leprosy. I suppose I have to put a footnote in here and say the word translated leprosy does not mean what we call leprosy, but some unknown skin disease. Now the Arameans, on one of their raids, had taken a young girl captive from the land of Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." So Naaman went in and told his lord just what the girl from the land of Israel had said. And the king of Aram said, "Go then, and I will send along a letter to the king of Israel." He went, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of garments. he brought the letter to the king of Israel, which read, "When this letter reaches you, know that I have sent my servant Naaman, that you may cure him of his leprosy." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to give death or life, that this man sends word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? Just look and see how he's trying to pick a quarrel with me." When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent a message to the king, "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me, that he may learn that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and halted at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, "Go wash in the Jordan 7 times and your flesh shall be restored and you shall be clean." But Naaman became angry and went away saying, "I thought that for me he would surely come out and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and would wave his hand over the spot and cure the leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" He turned and went away in a rage. But his servants approached him and said, "Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it? How much more when all he said to you was, 'Wash and be clean'?" So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. His flesh was restored like the flesh of a young boy, and he was clean. What do we learn by being taken into the movement of this story that we couldn't have told ourselves? There are a number of important features, some of which occur also in some folk tales, but not often in this concentration. Notice how the story is moved along not by the important figures, such as the two kings and Naaman himself, but by the minor players, the servant girl, Elisha the man of God, who seems a figure peripheral to the life of the court, Naaman's servants. The outcome lies in the hands of little people, while the major actors consistently get things wrong. The king of Aram misunderstands the advice he gets at second hand and assumes naturally that it's the king of Israel who has healing powers. The king of Israel suspects the king of Aram's sincerity and thus nearly aborts the plan. Indeed, he's probably on the brink of declaring war. Naaman himself angrily rejects Elisha's instructions, first because the prophet doesn't do him the honour of appearing in person, and then because the instructions seem so banal and insulting to Abana and Pharpar, rivers of Damascus. It's the insignificant people who in the end decide the outcome. Human beings do not usually assume that this will be so. It's not the kind of message we would work out for ourselves. It is, however, very consistent with the message of the New Testament, where the one who is servant of all becomes the saviour of the world. What's more, there's also a message in the fact that the miracle of healing is brought about by such mundane means. There is no magic invocation, simply an instruction to wash. As just mentioned, this is so disappointing to Naaman, he can hardly be brought to do it. And this is a consistent theme in the Bible. People overlook what is obvious and simple and build systems for themselves from which the power of God is actually absent. Biblical theology sees God present certainly in signs and wonders, but also, and perhaps more characteristically, in the trivial and insignificant, in Elijah's still small voice, rather than in storm and tempest and earthquake. Jesus himself seeks to hide his own miracles according to the Gospels, especially Mark with the so-called messianic secret. He doesn't do them to impress. In the wilderness, he resists the devil's temptation to perform a flamboyant act of power by throwing himself from the pinnacle of the temple so as to prove that God is with him. He rejects the solution of summoning hosts of angels to save him from his suffering on the cross. And he associates with lowly people, especially those whom society regards as not respectable or as beneath notice. And the story of Naaman in the Old Testament already suggests themes like this if we read it attentively. I want to move on to a little section which I've called open reading. Open reading. Because the ways of reading scripture I've just been describing could be called open approaches to reading. They contrast with going to the Bible with one's own fixed agenda, asking what it commands, or looking to it for doctrinal definitions. The Bible is not the kind of book that characteristically speaks to us through rulings or definitions. Only a tiny part of it is like that. Most of it consists of narrative, poetry or proverbs, the type of literature we have to immerse ourselves in and let it shape our way of thinking and being. Only in St. Paul's letters do we encounter discursive material that sets out to inform us of what we should believe and do as Christians. And even there, the teaching emerges from specific situations of conflict in the early churches, and it's not presented as timeless instructions for all times and places. And occasionally, Paul even says, "This is my advice, but I'm not sure whether it comes from God or not." Now, this characteristic of Scripture has been described by a German colleague of mine as the productive vagueness of Scripture, the productive vagueness of Scripture, which I like. And many people find it difficult to cope with. They want precise answers to exact questions, not the sort of untidy, rambling stories and evocative but imprecise poems that seem to make up so much of the Bible. If we believe, however, that the Bible comes from God, then God must want us not only to have a book to which we can turn, but a book of just this type, rather than a manual of doctrine or a legal code. Our wisdom as Christians comes from letting ourselves be open to what it is that a book like this can teach us, letting ourselves be open to its flow, not closing down the possibilities for meaning that come from encountering its characteristic styles and genres. So in reading and reflecting on a section of the Bible, the most important thing is to let the text pose its own questions to us, as well as giving us its own answers. Revelation is not divine answers to the questions in an examination we set God. God challenges our questions just as much as he challenges our answers. And this is very obvious in many of the sayings of Jesus. Jesus does not usually answer the question he is asked, but redefines it and throws it back at the questioner in a way which must have been absolutely infuriating. I saw a statistic the other day, which I can't remember because I can never remember statistics, but it showed that of all the questions asked Jesus in the Gospels, he only answers about two of them. And with the others, he replies very often the question of his own. Matthew 22:22-23 is a perfect example. This is where Jesus is asked about the resurrection of the dead through the cleverly constructed case designed to make him look foolish of the woman who married seven brothers. You remember that? Instead of replying to the question asked, he goes beneath it to the more basic principle of how God deals with human beings and finds another text that speaks of the God to whom all people live. He refers back to the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob rather than staying with the question as put. He does not see the Bible as the solution to a set of conundrums, but as a revelation of God's ways with his creation, a revelation that can be appropriated only by those who are prepared to open themselves to meditate on Scripture, rather than forcing it to answer their own clever questions. We may come to the Bible wanting to know how we are to live, especially in the complicated settings in which we work and function nowadays. What the Bible gives us is a variety of models, and it invites us to turn them in our mind and heart until the penny drops and we see our way clearly. But this does not happen through the Bible filling in the answers to our questionnaire, but rather like an icon working on us transformatively as we open ourselves up to its gaze. So I come finally to the question of biblical criticism. The talk was billed as biblical criticism in a secular culture, and you may think I've said nothing about biblical criticism at all. Biblical criticism is surely all about the origins and sources of biblical texts. JEDP in the Pentateuch, four letters that strike horror into the heart of any undergraduate studying Old Testament. The synoptic problem and Q. Reconciling or refusing to reconcile Paul with Acts, reconstructing the original prophets, and all those sorts of things. Now, biblical criticism does have that side to it, and that's been very important, and continues to be. But it is a much broader concept than all this. It arises from the desire to read the Bible with understanding, and it's focused on a number of things, I think, that I've been stressing in this lecture. One is the importance of context, so that we see each text in its original setting, not lifted out of it and made non-specific, as though we can reduce the texts to general principles and then throw the text away. Another is the importance of genre, so that we don't read narratives as though they were law, or poems as if they were prose. There are indeed passages that are law in the Bible, and how we are meant to react to them, given the very different world they often come from, is a well-known problem for modern Christians, particularly difficult for our own church at present, of course, where issues of sexuality are concerned, as we all know. But very little of the Bible is actually legal. There are very few prescriptions or proscriptions. A third important thing is the cruciality of reading the text, as I've tried to illustrate, in an open way, not forcing it into a straitjacket of our own devising. And a fourth, which follows from this, is the ability to be surprised by the text. All these are essential elements in critical reading, which I've tried to illustrate. A critical approach to the Bible is not so much critical of the Bible as critical of our own uses of it. It represents an attempt to get the Bible to be itself, freed from the distortions of how people have sometimes read it. The synoptic problem, for example, doesn't arise from a desire to splinter the text, but from the attempt to read what is actually there in the four Gospels, which very soon results in seeing what is really obvious, namely that they have some kind of complicated interrelationship that needs to be explained. Once we've seen that, we can't pretend to our secular contemporaries that they all tell exactly the same story and that they have an absolute authority of the kind that might belong to a single official document. But this insight arises simply from an open and free reading of the texts that is prepared to criticise some traditional attitudes in the light of what is clearly there in the biblical text. And in that sense, all the approaches I've tried to outline do belong, I would say, to biblical criticism. A useful book I read a little while ago sums it up like this, and I quote, "We cannot afford to be too selective about what we encounter in the Bible. God's saving of us takes place by dragging us beyond our own comfort zone into new territory and new adventures. It is an act by which we are drawn or even compelled to leave behind the boundaries that our selfhood has imposed upon our lives. We are called to transcend our own limited vision of the good life and to accept something of the all-inclusiveness of God's plan for human fulfillment." And the book I'm quoting that from is a book called Sacred Reading, which is a guide to the practice of Lectio Divina. But it seems to me that it can stand very well also as a description of what I mean when I say biblical criticism. To read the Bible critically is to allow it to be itself, which is both very difficult and very necessary. A critical reader of the Bible, like a literary critic reading any other text, is concerned primarily with what is actually there. And in the case of the Bible, the noise of traditional interpretation can be so great that it blocks the text out so that we can't hear it. We can only contribute from the Bible to the needs and questions of our secular contemporaries if we can first read it in that sense critically ourselves. Thank you very much.